नमस्ते, वेलकम टू वीटीयू ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम, द ई लर्निंग प्लेटफॉर्म अंडर विश्वेश्वरय टेक्नोलॉजिकल यूनिवर्सिटी बेलगावी कर्नाटक. आई एम डॉक्टर दाक्षायणी आर पाटिल एंड आई वेलकम यू ऑल वंस अगेन. आई एम असोसिएट प्रोफेसर एट बीएमएस कॉलेज ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर बैंगलोर बुल टेम्पल रोड. द कोर्स वी आर डीलिंग विद इज बिल्डिंग सर्विसेज 3 18 ERC 6-3 for BHAG 6th semester for the term 2021. So VTU presents this wonderful e-learning center and platform to float these e-sessions for the classes. Now under the building services course, I will be dealing with modules 1 and 2, of which module 1 sessions have been completed. We are currently with a module 2 and this is lecture 2 under module 2 dealing with air conditioning systems. So air conditioning system, and this is the overview of the syllabus, overview of the references listed in the syllabus. So let us commence lecture 2 under module 2 under the title air conditioning systems, and the content would be the first 3 we have completed in lecture 1. So this session will take a look at the types and components of a typical air conditioning system, the classifications of air conditioning systems, and introduction to the two types of unitary and central air conditioning systems. So types of AC, based on function, we have two categories, comfort AC and process or industrial AC. So comfort AC, the main function or objective is to create indoor environments that are conducive or comfortable to the people in terms of regulated temperature, humidity, what else? Air velocity and cleanliness. Process or industrial AC will aim at providing ambient indoor climates for conducting processes of various degrees, manufacturing, testing, laboratories, etc. And based on operating system, we will have two categories, unitary AC and central AC. Unitary ACs will refer to small equipment, small scale, for example, window AC, split AC, package AC. Central AC for large installations, large building areas, big built-up zones. And we will have two types in that, direct or DX system and chilled water system. Now, components of a typical air conditioning system. Normally, the basic components, broadly speaking, will cover these aspects. A heating source. We are regulating the indoor temperature of the air by heating it during cold seasons or cooling it during hot seasons. So, heating source has to be there to enable such a heating. Cooling source has to be there to enable cooling of the air or regulating the temperature to lower calibrations. There has to be a distribution system. So, you have these equipment which are undertaking the heating or cooling. So, from there, the heated or cooled air has to go to the respective zones where people are using. So you need a distribution network or a system in place. So that will envisage as ducts, ducting system in the equipment. Then the equipment itself, the various components, the air handling unit, the motors, etc. The devices. Devices would refer to the interface devices like thermostats, operating panels, and so forth. So these comprise basic components of a typical air conditioning system of various scale. Now, what are the components of the AC system? Continuing, the heating source is the one which adds heat to a fluid. The fluid could be air, water, or steam. Cooling source, it removes heat from a fluid, and the fluid is air or water. Distribution system refers to the network of ducts or piping to carry the fluid to the rooms to be heated or cooled. They are like the nerves in a human body, which carry the fluid from one part to another. The equipment that include fans, pumps for enabling the movement of the air or water. By itself, the fluid doesn't know which side to flow. So this has to be reinforced or enabled with an equipment such as a fan or a pump. Various devices for transferring heat between the fluid and the room. Now, these main components are supported with other components. And what are they? The automatic controls. The control mechanism for calibrating, for monitoring, for adjusting the system to the required parameters. Safety devices, of course. Now, this process of air conditioning involves a lot of mechanical process, which involves energy consumption, and there is a need to enable the system with safety mechanism for anything between voltage increase in heat, or increase beyond the stipulated thresholds of safety of temperature, heat, etc. Valves to switch on and off any kind of fluid movement to control that. In instances of maintenance procedures happening, we need to shut off the flow of the fluid. The valves come handy in turning it off as a central system. Dampers. Now, dampers are very interesting elements. They are the small doors in the system which will allow the right amount of fluid air moving to the other point. So it controls the movement of air by controlling the quantity and flow. So dampers are used very efficiently. Sometimes we need dampers to mix the hot and cold air, cooled air, and so forth. And also dampers to introduce the inlet, fresh air inlet for ventilation purposes. Insulation. Very interesting. Now, you are conditioning the air in a space. The space has to be insulated, definitely. Otherwise, the conditioned air is not going to remain conditioned for long. When it is infiltrated by the heat from outside or from outside, inside to outside. So you need to insulate the space properly. Apart from that, the ducts, the transportation elements, network elements are running through non-conditioned spaces. So you need to insulate the ducts so that there is less loss in the conditioned air in terms of temperature, humidity, etc. Vibration reduction devices. Now, mechanically so much of process happening in the equipment, there is every likelihood that there is a substantial vibration that is happening because of the air flowing through the ducts and in the spaces. Now, classification of the AC system, we have two types. All water system, which is called as hydronic system, which use water as heating or cooling fluid. All right. So we have the first category, which is all water system, which is also called as hydronic systems. This uses water as heating as or cooling fluid. Then we have all air system, which uses air as the fluid for enabling heating or cooling aspects. Thirdly, we have air-water system. So it uses both air and water, combination of both. Now, there are places where water might not be readily available or comfortably available. So then air is used. Air is, of course, definitely available everywhere. So air system could be used. And there are some which would want to tap the positives or advantages of both air and water. So they inculcate air and water system. So we have these three types available with respect to the fluid that is used for heating or cooling. Let us take a look at the schematic diagram for a hydronic heating system. Okay. Now, arrangement of basic components of a hydronic hot water heating system is discussed here. So what do we have? Firstly, we have the heating source. So hot water boiler, HW boiler in the bracket. So hot water supply duct, which is operated by means of the pump at serial number 2. Then the piping, which takes it to the terminal unit. So you have a room shown here, and it could be branched to other rooms as well. So from there, it's a cyclic process. The hot water must return from the other rooms back to the heat source. So as a cyclic process, the heat source, the pump, the room to be heated, and back to the heat source. You will have the terminal unit, which could be the AC unit that you normally see that is installed on the wall of a room or ceiling. And you will have the user interface by means of thermostat or remote control usage. So it works in this manner. And only water is used as the fluid medium to enable this kind of a heating system in the AC. We need to calculate the room heat loss also. So accordingly, heat loads are calculated. We have done a chapter on heat load calculation in the module 1, where we understood how heat loss or heat gain in a space is calculated using the formulas that we have, and based on that we decide what should be the capacity of the air conditioning unit, either in terms of heating or cooling. This is the hydronic cooling system, all water cooling system, also called as chilled water cooling system, because we are using chilled water as a medium for providing the cool air to the space. So we have a cooling source here, which can be called as the water chiller. From there, the chilled water supply ducts via the pump move to the spaces that have to be cooled. It could be one room, multiple rooms. It's a network. So from there, the chilled water return ducts from other rooms join the main duct, and it is taken to the cooling source, where again it undergoes the process of chilling the air and pumping back to the required units or to the terminal unit. So between the heating, in the heating system, we have the heat source, which is a boiler. In the water, in the cooling system, we have the chiller plant. So boiler for heating, chiller plant for cooling. And only water is used as the medium to enable heating or cooling, right? So is that clear? All right, thank you. Let's move to the next system, which is hydronic heating and cooling together. So this is an all water system, and it is a system to enable both heating and cooling at the same time. Heating during winters, cooling during summers. So previously we saw only cooling, only heating. So this is a system which enables heating and cooling together. So what should we have here? We should have a heating source. We should have a cooling source, right? Yes. So from the heating or cooling source, we have the valves which are controlling the flow of the water, because during winters you have to switch off the valve of the cooling source and vice versa. So from there, the hot water supply or the chilled water supply ducts take it to the pump, which enables pumping of the same to the room or the terminal unit and returns back to the respective systems. So very wonderfully, this is a system which enables both heating and cooling. So you can draw this simple sketch, label the parts and explain the principle on its base, on what it's based, and the process that happens through the system. The next type is all air system. So only air is used as the fluid medium to enable heating and cooling. So what do we see here? Let us begin. The dotted line that you see, right? So that is the equipment may be packaged as a single unit, or they could remain as separate units. Both possibilities are there. So we have the heat source as the number one. I hope you can see my cursor. Yeah, thank you. So you have the heat source at one, then fan. Okay, let us finish off the elements that are in the package. You have the heat source, you have the cooling source. So heat source comes into action during winters, cooling source during the summer. You will have the valves to control that. You have a humidifier. So during low humidity days, it introduces humidification. During high humidity days, it removes the humidity, called as dehumidification. Then you have the air filters, which are going to clean the air from the impurities. It is going to arrest the impurities that are laden in the air. So we need air filters in place. Then you have the fan, which creates the necessary suction or throw power. The supply duct, which is going to take the chilled air or heated air with high temperature to the rooms. The room could be single, a set of rooms. It could be anything on that particular floor. So the ducts will carry the air to the rooms and back from the room to the unit again, to be conditioned again. And number seven, you will have the outdoor air, which is used to ventilate the space and also to cool the heating source, sometimes a condenser. Okay, so outside air is required to enable these two things. Then you have the exhaust air, to remove the used air from the system to the outside. So a certain percentage of air is conditioned, recycled and sent back. Certain percentage of the air is exhausted to the outside to maintain the required parameters of safe, clean air in the system. So is that clear? All air, heating and cooling, air conditioning system. Now, let us begin with the system types. Unitary systems, as the nomenclature reads, unit. Unit is a small component. Scale can be visualized, not too large. It's a unit system, unitary system, something single, singular usage. A unitary AC system uses equipment where all or most of the basic components of the refrigeration cycle are assembled in the factory. So it's a unit which is already produced, manufactured in the factory and embedded as a single case or unit. All the components in a single unit is called as a unitary system. It is factory manufactured and factory assembled. Example, window AC or unit AC. You might have frequently seen this particular unit sitting in the windows of your homes or offices or labs. Another example, rooftop units. So window AC is a small equipment, small spatial output. Rooftop units are large units which cannot sit at the window and they have higher capacities, so they go on the roof. They are called as rooftop units. We will come across these in typologies like supermarkets or large scale refrigeration units, cold storage units, or big commercial establishments. So this is the image of a right. It's a window AC. Window AC, unitary system, which sits royally on the window sill. It's front to the inside and backside to the outside. This is an example of a rooftop air conditioning system. Quite a massive one, royally sitting on the terrace. Structurally well assembled with a sturdy base, and it houses the equipment for undertaking the AC to a large capacity output. And to the right side of the screen, that's behind, you are seeing the cooling towers. We're going to cover that later. So ducts and pipes and electrical conduits, panels for shutting off and on, viewing panels. These are the doors to maintain them. The view panel, filters, large scale. So that was a brief understanding about unitary systems. Now the second type, based on the scale of the unit, we have central air conditioning systems. So that was unit, this is central. So it must mean that some mass that is centrally sitting to provide air conditioning from that centralized control to a large space in the building. It will it sits in the central location and air conditioning the entire building mass, all the spaces in the building. So very large capacities. It uses equipment centrally located in the mechanical equipment rooms. So it requires a lot of technically sound installations and a good amount of skill set or man skills or consultants coming into picture here. Factory assembled window ACs or split ACs, package ACs are get it from the factory, gets delivered to your house, and a technician comes and very quickly installs it. For the window AC, you might not even require that if you are able to, but still a small amount of technical assistance would be required. For split AC, we may require a little substantial amount. We are going to see these in detail in the coming session. Each piece of equipment is installed separately and interconnected as per the cycle that is required on the job. So a good amount of technical work is required for installing central air conditioning systems, and you have specified engineers and consultants who are service providers for these kind of installations. It is not manufactured as a single package. No, it always comes as different components that have to be selected carefully for the required load and sourced from the right vendor, from the right agency, and installed on site along with lot of other things like ducting, pipings, electrical, waterworks, etc. Civil also. So they are quite substantially complex spaces. This is a picture of an AC plant. You will have the control panels, ducts moving in multiple things, hung from the ceiling, from the system. So boilers, coolers, cooling tanks are on the terrace normally. And a sturdy base. So you see the ducts, main ducts, turnings, these are called as duct elbows. The right cross section of ducts have to be visualized and calibrated. So complex central air conditioning systems. Now, since we are moving ahead, at this point, I would wish to recollect all that we have studied in the module 1 so far. You can find these 11 lecture videos on the e-learning platform, e-Sikshana platform, and on BTU as well. So what have we learned so far? The importance of human comfort for indoor environments and the parameters of comfort in terms of temperature, pressure, velocity, and cleanliness. Indoor air quality, IAQs, and what does it mean, and what are the parameters, how it is estimated. So we had seen that carbon dioxide is one of the parameters for judging indoor air quality, IAQs. Physical properties of air, most important section that we have studied. Understanding air and its behavioral tendencies under different circumstances. The science of psychrometry. Psychrometry to let us understand air. Map the various parameters. Do you remember what were the parameters that were plotted on a psychrometric chart? Or a psychrometric graph? What are the parameters that were plotted on a psychrometric chart? Very right. Dry bulb temperature, wet bulb temperature, relative humidity, specific heat, enthalpy, absolute humidity, right? We saw that wonderful graph which plotted all these and made our mathematical calculations easier. Psychrometry chart is one of the very essential tools to arrive at comfort conditions in a very easy manner. And there was an exercise floated. I hope you were able to do that. Let me know. Then we learned the various fundamentals. What were they? Specific heat, enthalpy, total heat content, all these, and understanding the units of measurement of each and the rule of thermodynamics on which our entire realm of refrigeration and air conditioning is based on. Then we saw the refrigeration cycle, if you recollect, vapor compression cycle and vapor absorption cycle, the various components like the evaporator, condenser, compressor, throttling device, and how the refrigerant was the savior fluid, which is taking up the heat from our space and giving to the outside. So please recollect all those. Heat load estimation we did. There was a set of parameters like how heat is gained in a space. What is the major source of heat gain? Right, the solar heat gain. And it enters your building through conduction, convection, radiation. So we understood how the walls are giving us heat or giving away heat, the roofs, the floor, the windows, the glass, and internal. What were the three parameters of heat gain? Yes, very right. People, lighting, and equipment. So we understood the formulas for calculating the heat gain by these modes and how it would help us in deciding the tonnage for our air conditioning. Then we understood the HVAC principles, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning principles, and what were the hierarchy of responsibility as an architect in the entire scheme of things. We saw the flow chart and the mode of operation of designing a HVAC with its various components, right? So HVAC as a larger backdrop for our understanding. So please go through this, because we are doing air conditioning systems ahead. So we need to strengthen our foundation before we proceed. So as an exercise to conclude our lecture 1 and lecture 2 sessions under module 2, section 3, could you please discuss the advantages and disadvantages of air conditioning in buildings? I haven't deliberately done that, but I wish you undertake this exercise of analyzing how AC has given us the good things and what are the disadvantages. Every coin has two sides. So discuss the advantages and disadvantages of air conditioning in buildings. For example, positives we already know. We have been talking how the temperature regulates pressure, etc. How it is helpful in building uses like intensive care units in hospitals. But what are the disadvantages? Yes, the use of refrigerants which are harming the atmosphere. The consumption of energy. Substantial contribution to energy consumption in a building, and how can we as architects, engineers, and technical expertise create better working sustainable units. The R&D is continuously ongoing. Then I mentioned briefly sometime in the lecture on the Montreal Protocol, so kindly visit that. What was the understandings or decisions taken by various nations as a unilateral voluntary decision, and it has been so many years now. So post that, what has been the response in India on this entire field of air conditioning and creating safer refrigerants? I think we should revisit that and evaluate ourselves on the stand. So please conduct these exercises as conclusions under lecture 1 and 2 sessions of module 2. So the next lecture, following lectures, we will be seeing the unitary AC systems under unitary windows, split, and package. Three types of ACs we will be seeing in the forthcoming e-sessions under this. So thank you for being here, and see you ahead.